All right, so Ron, you first. Our minds already made up before they're even to hear the testimonies about these allegations from these two?
I think most minds are made up, but at the margin, you know, is where it could be decided. On the one hand, you do have a number of Republicans, Mitch McConnell, Lindsey Graham, even before today, the candidates running in North Dakota, Dana Rohrabacher was quoted today in the LA Times, all being very dismissive of this. And that probably is the vast majority of Republican senators. But of course, it only takes two Republican senators to derail it. And the same thing on the Democratic side. I mean, the vast majority of Democrats, I think, as the senator from Hawaii noted, have tremendous questions about his credibility and veracity already based on his answers about at least three other matters that came up in his confirmation hearing. But there are a few red state Democrats who have been on the fence, and I think it does matter for them. So, yes, the vast majority have their minds made up, mm-hmm. but it is at the margin where this will be decided.
And Professor Jordan, is this deja vu? Were minds already made up when Anita Hill began her testimony?
Absolutely. The minds were made up, and the framework for hearing what she had to say was set in a very basic way. Clarence Thomas tossed the question back on the all-white male committee when he said, this is a high-tech lynching. And so he put the racial element in the fore, and he put the senators on the defensive. And when the senators began to question him, he essentially said, I'm not answering lies. And so the minds were made up. The candidate, the nominee, was allowed to push the senators into a corner of racial discrimination, citing the Southern history. And of course, it didn't help that Senator Hal Heflin was the questioner who was asked to question Clarence Thomas. So minds are made up. Some of this has to do with our current situation about the unreported sexual harassment in the nation. We know we are living in a sea, an ocean of unreported sexual predation from our religious institutions, entertainment industry. Why should we be surprised when someone nominated to the highest court in the land has an issue of this sort coming forward? We need a clear problem-solving approach to deal with this in advance so that we're not surprised, minds made up on both sides, opposite ways, without taking into account the human beings. You don't plow through human experience. There's an expectation that our leaders, senators, will take the opportunity to show the country how this particular problem of the massive underreporting of sexual crimes or sexual harassment can be solved. It's too late when we get to this high-stakes setting.
So now, in the meantime, it's this Thursday, it's 10 a.m., and, you know, Professor, we have already heard through the reporting, through Deborah Katz, the legal team, you know, for Dr. Ford, that she is under duress. She has had to be separated from her family because of security concerns. Her email has been hacked. It's not safe and comfortable to be back home. So then talk to me about how would you be advising her? How did you have to advise or prepare Anita Hill under such duress and then be able to tell, you know, this very delicate story, this very personal account in front of an all-male, mostly all-male, you know, committee and to the world?
Well, you know, we had the ideal client. Anita Hill was a law professor. She had worked in the public arena in Washington, D.C. before at the Department of Education and also at the EEOC. And she was teaching at Oral Roberts University. So she was accustomed to a certain level of scrutiny, but nobody can be prepared for this kind of intense smear campaign that can be unleashed. So I think our preparation for her was essentially to press her with questions that might be a little bit of a surprise for her and to see how she reacted. as we can see over the last 26 years, 27 years, she has held up quite well because she's a very centered person. And I can only hope and wish that Dr. Ford has that same fortitude from her family, from her own experience, from her life, to be able to stand up to this. Mm-hmm. This is more than we should expect from any citizen who wants to contribute to what we know about a Supreme Court nominee.
Yeah, and Ron, again, there are no GOP women in this committee. There are four Democratic women. However, testimony, you know, while it's scheduled for Thursday, so many minds made up. Do you see that, you know, it is going to be difficult for either one, Dr. Ford or even Judge Kavanaugh, you know, to really go beyond, you know, the testimony? I mean, both will forever, you know, I guess, be scarred by what transpires this week.
Well, first of all, I mean, I think it is correct that Republicans have steered this in a way to maximize the possibility that that Americans will view it essentially as a he said, she said kind of collision by not having a more exhaustive investigation before the fact and refusing to bring anyone else in under oath and thus having just the two of them as a protagonist. I would point out, I would flag a tweet today from Jerry Nadler of New York, who would be the chair of the House Judiciary Committee if Democrats win the majority in the House, who said that essentially if the Republicans will not subpoena these other witnesses, the House Judiciary Committee certainly could down the road. I'm not sure that if he is confirmed on a party line vote and Democrats win the House, that this is the end of the investigation, because certainly Democrats feel it is being short-circuited. And it's worth noting that, you know, the Anita Hill testimony is credited with instigating the or igniting the original Year of the Woman in 1992. There were 70 Democratic women nominated for the House in 1992. It's 183 this time, over one-third of which are women of color. Polls out again today, the widest gender gap we have seen, particularly among African-American women and college-educated white women. The Republicans realize, I think, they are playing with fire against the backdrop of what is already transpiring in this election, largely as a reaction to President Trump. So this is really high stakes, even if they can hold their party together to get to a narrow confirmation.
Yeah, and as it pertains to potential investigations, it has been, you know, said that there is no statute of limitations on this kind of offense in Maryland, and thereby it is possible that there could be some other investigation that ensues, regardless of, you know, what the testimony is or the confirmation outcome is, that is, in Maryland. We'll see. Professor Emma Coleman Jordan, Ron Brownstein, good to see you both. Appreciate it.
Thank you.